Hello guys, so in this second video we'll be talking about the evolution and ecology of odonates. And you know about the dragonfly biology in general, you may be already knowing that they have aquatic and semi-aquatic life cycle and how they are aerial predators and so on. So I'm not going to talk about that. What I'm going to talk about is how they evolved. So you may be wondering from where these dragonflies came. So the research shows that they came, they evolved around 400 million years ago, which is really a long back. I can't really imagine what happened at that time. But these were the only and first insects to fly. And if you have seen some movies like Jurassic Park and so on, you must have seen these big giant insects flying. So these were at that time dragonflies, which were really huge in size, and they were like, they had like 2 to 3 feet long wingspan, which is really huge for an insect. And this basically happened because there was an increased concentration of oxygen in the air, and to deal with this increased amount of oxygen, these insects, they grew in size so as to reduce their surface area, which basically reduced the absorption of oxygen. And in a way, they deal with the toxicity of oxygen in the air. But as the, over the time, as the oxygen concentration decreased in air, their sizes also decreased. So you can wonder really how these insects are well adapted to the external environment. And that's why they are also good ecological indicators that you must have read in many newspapers and many news articles, that how odonates are good ecological indicators. So the evolution is something of historical significance, and it basically tells us that how these species evolved and how they may cope up with the future climate or future changes that are going to happen. So there is a PPT, there is a small PDF file that I have given to present it, and we'll be showing you that odonata evolution PPT. So I'm just going to talk with respect to that PPT. So the very first slide is about a very nice poem that you should all read, and it's a poem by a prominent scientist, Professor Madhav Gadgil. That poem basically tells what a dragonfly is, and you should carefully read that, and after this talk you will really get an idea why that poem has been written. That poem appears on the field guide of Indian odonata in the Subramanian's book, on the first page of that book. So you may be familiar with that poem. And in the very next slide you will see a fossil, a rock on which there is a fossil of a dragonfly. It's actually impression on the rock, and that basically tells that these were really big, huge insects in historical times. And as you proceed through this PPT, you will see that huge these insects were as compared to human. So there is a very nice graph depicting that. So basically, this is what we know, and then there is more complicated stuff that I'm not going to talk about right now, because at this stage it's not required. But what is required is how wonderful these insects are. So this PPT basically tells you that there are these many insects, these many dragonflies in the world, and these many in India. So that doesn't really matter, don't worry about that. So what matters is how they are classified. So currently they are classified in three different suborders. The first is Anisoptera, which is dragonflies. So un means non, and isos means symmetrical. So dragonflies don't have symmetrical wings, that's why they are called Anisoptera. Ptera means wings, so Anisoptera. Damselflies are Zygoptera. Zygos mean similar, and Ptera means wings. So they have similarly sized wings. So that's why Zygoptera are damselflies. And then there is another class called dragon damselfly, which is a sort of a combination of both these classes. That's called Anisozygoptera. So these particular Anisozygopterans, they are really rare, and they represent evolutionary link basically. and there are only four species belonging to a single family that exist. So this is something that we should all know before we really go into the ecology, which is contemporary biology of species that we are going to study. So evolution is something which really has an effect of what a species is now today. So in next few minutes, I'll be talking about the Odonata ecology. And when I say ecology, it is a really broad subject. It contains the species biology, for example, how the species reproductive behavior is, you know, how the species copes with the habitat it lives in. And there are like habitat ecology, landscape ecology, which is also one should study. And habitat ecology basically would have how the habitat parameters affect the species. If there are anthropogenic factors that are affecting the species, such as pollution or, you know, the land use change that we often see, then how to count the species, how to count the number of odonates that you see. And so basically there are many, many, many things that are involved in ecology. And I think till now you must have an introduction to taxonomy and how to identify odonates. But what I'm talking is also very important, and it is something often a bit of advanced level, because unless you know the identification of the species, you cannot really go for an ecological studies. So the taxonomy and the natural history of any species is very, very, very important for studying its evolution and ecology. So you should keep this in mind. So when we do ecological studies, we have to carry out surveys. And during these surveys, we have to follow a system. So unless you do a systematic survey, the surveys may not be comparable across the locations, and your data may not be really useful. Now there is another PPT with Prasenjit about the Odonata ecology, Odonata surveys basically, and it says how to do a survey, why to do a survey, and when to do a survey. So all these questions are basically answered in this, and it's a long PPT, but I'm just going to give a brief about that. So here, these surveys are of various kinds. Some of them are judgment-based surveys, in which you have a judgment where a species will be seen, and then you really go there and really look for that particular species. So that's a totally a judgment-based survey. There are other systematic surveys, such as, you know, the random surveys or randomized sampling or stratified randomized sampling. So you may not really have any difficulty understanding this, because most of you might have already gone through these kind of statistical methods. And if you have any questions, you can ask Prasenjit. I'm sure he knows all this stuff. Now the more important point is, why do you want to do a survey? So unless you do a survey, you do not really get an idea of how many species are there in a particular locality. So if you do a survey, you have a hypothesis, and the hypothesis basically tells that in this particular time, in this particular sampling method, I found so many species. And this basically gives you confidence about, you know, sharing your results. So that is very important in science. So unless you do surveys, unless you do follow a system and then replicate this, so that is also very important. You have to replicate things. You have to do a particular experiment. For example, walking a transect. If you just walk a transect, but do that repetitively, because if you do a repetitive work, then the error will get reduced. For example, if you are one day, suppose I go to this Gormara National Park, I walk a transect of 1 kilometer, and then I find, say, some 20 species, okay? And I find one particular enigmatic species, for example, say, some gomphid which I have never seen. So, and based on that, I cannot write a paper or a report saying that there are 20 species in Gormara National Park. That is logically wrong, because you never know what is there beyond 1 kilometer, because you just walked 1 kilometer. You never know what is going to be there next day, because you just did the survey today. So you have to do repetitions, and you have to cover as much as of your area, so that to get a better idea of how the surveys are going to help. And at the end of any survey, you should have some data, which is also mentioned in PPT, which is basically the number of species, how many species you saw, the number of individuals that you saw, and also other variables such as if you see any habitat parameters, if you really counted any habitat parameters, and so on. Now, a tricky thing is dragonflies and damselflies, they have different habits. So when you survey them together, it becomes really difficult, because when you are walking a transect or when you are sitting somewhere and looking around for dragonflies, you may often see more dragonflies than damselflies, because dragonflies readily fly around, but damselflies are hidden in grasses. So these kind of things also may matter in recording the number of species that you see. So you have to keep all these things in mind. And also, some particular species have a particular breeding season or flight period. For example, gomphids are generally seen pre-monsoon in the peninsula of India. So if you go for surveys in post-monsoon season, you may expect a lesser number of gomphids in your list. So to cover the other remaining gomphids that you may not have seen, you should also go to pre-monsoon season, which is like summer season, and you should also survey during that. So all these things are also very important when you do a survey. So in this video, I cannot really explain all the things, but there is a PPT and you can go through the PPT. And if you have any question, you can write to me on my email ID, which is also mentioned on the PPT. And you can also contact me, Prasanjit has my number, and I'll be very happy to answer any of your queries. And I'm sure Dipti is there, who was also working on the similar aspects, and she also can guide you. There is Neha, last year we found some very interesting observation. I hope she is going to talk about that. And so odonates and dragonflies are not only for identification. There is a lot more that we can do. There is behavioral biology that we can study, there is habitat biology that we can study, and it does have a landscape level implication. It's not only a species limited stuff that we do. So suppose you have some endemic species occurring in a particular area, you can really lobby for that area, because when dragonflies are there, when there are sensitive species in a particular area, it means there are some other species which are also sensitive in that area. So it's they are really ecological indicators, and you should see them in that way. But before doing anything, you should first test whether they are ecological indicator for your area or not. So that's something very interesting, and you should explore this this PPD, and there are some methods which I have mentioned that you can go through. There is some grid-wise methods also that you can also go through, and there are some papers that I have given. So it will be really great if you could go through those papers, and then you will get a better idea of if you are really going for some surveys. Apart from that, if you have any queries, do write to me. I'll be very delighted to answer your queries. And in this meet, it will be great if you could do some sort of a small research segment and find something which nobody has noted down till now. Maybe you can do some surveys, random surveys, and make a list, or you can even really look out for some behavior, some interesting behavior that you could see. And I'm hoping that if you could publish that, it will be really great, because in Indian odonatology, there are very few studies that are happening, and it will be really a great contribution, because we have so many endemic species, but we really do not know much about that. So I hope you enjoyed this video also, and hope to see you in next year's meeting, wherever it happens. But I'm sure I'll be there. Thank you.